Good morning, church. My name is Pastor Lisa T Chiriseri from His Presence Ministries International, Epworth Assembly. That's right, Epworth Assembly, one of the most popping branches of this church. It is an absolute honor and privilege to be sharing God's word on the platform today. And I would like to honor our apostle, Commissioner Petunia Chiriseri. I'd like to honor our senior pastors, our pastors, my pastors, Pastor Miona Rabukwa and Tembi Mbe from HPMI Borrowdale, and welcome every single member of HPMI as well as our guests on today's platform. Today is Sunday, the 29th of August, 2021, and I'm taking part two of the series, Those Who Forget. This series is based on books by Bishop Dag Ewood Mills. Books that we were recommended, highly recommended by both our apostles, Charles and Petunia Chiriseri, to read. Because when they came across Bishop Dyke's books, it was literally like he was speaking the very same words that we have been taught as a ministry for years and years. And so we're going to get right into it. Last week we learned that forgetting is unrighteous. It is sin to fail to remember. It is sin to fail to acknowledge. Hebrews 10 verse 6 says, God is not unrighteous to forget your labor of love which you have showed towards his name, and that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. We love that scripture, and we often quote it when we are chronicling the amazing things that we have done towards God or for the kingdom and expecting God to bless us. But we miss that forgetting is referred to as unrighteousness. It is unfathomable before God how one can forget him. He actually compares it in Jeremiah 2 verse 32 to a bride forgetting her wedding garments. I mean, imagine that. It is equally unfathomable how people can forget some of the most significant people in their lives. People who raised them, people who fed them and clothed them, people who funded their education, people who led them to Christ for the very first time, people who mentored them into ministry. However, we see this happen so much. We see it happen in families. We see it happen in homes. We see it happen with extended family. We see it happen in business. And atheism is probably the saddest state which we witness. When people reach a certain level of success and wealth, they begin to believe that there is no God. And sadly, we also see this so often, too often, in the Church of the Living God. It is the nature of God to remember. Therefore, it is ungodly to forget. Jesus never acted self-made. And if we are to be like him, then we cannot be those that forget. Jesus said that he could do nothing apart from the Father who sent him. We learned last week that you bring curses on yourself when you forget. We learned that it is often when you are too full and too satisfied that you forget. Let us choose to be those that are prosperous and mindful, prosperous and grateful, prosperous and humble, prosperous and obedient, prosperous and still able to give honor where honor is due. We learned that forgetting leads to pride. I worked so hard to be here is a popular pagan phrase that completely ignores the hand of God in our lives. And once we are prosperous, let's not fall into the trap. The trap of, I'm too busy to attend cell groups. I'm too rich to pay tithe. I'm too educated to be involved in these menial issues. I'm too spiritual to participate in admin work. Never let your gift cause you to forget where you came from, who brought you to where you are, and some of your past sins and mistakes too, because those will remind you to be humble. Those will enable you to treat others with kindness too. Remembrance is important because it makes you appreciate and preach about salvation, walk in your calling. It keeps you humble. It makes you grateful. It makes you kind and helpful. It makes you sensitive to others in similar or worse positions. And remember, evil befalls the forgetful. We learned that those that are forgetful are often constantly demoted. Remember, Proverbs 16 verse 18 says, pride comes before a fall. Remembering leads to promotion. Look at David. He remembered how God had caused him to kill the lion and the bear, and therefore he was able to drop Goliath. The forgetful often repeat mistakes. Be the person that chooses to fail forward. The forgetful often lower themselves because they forget the word of God. They forget his promises. They forget their standards. They forget to give honor. We often refuse to link our failures in life to forgetfulness because this is the hard truth. In school, you forget the answer. You fail the exams. In life's challenges, you forget your testimonies, Revelations chapter 12 verse 11, and you cannot overcome the situation that faces you today. In relationships, you forget your standards. You compromise and you sin. You mess that up. In ministry, you forget who you are. You forget your calling. You forget the vision of your church, and you start being taken by societal pressures and what other pastors are doing in other churches, and you become completely nothing like who God created you to be just to stay relevant. Forgetfulness equals murmuring, equals grumbling, equals discontentment, bitterness, pride, and other evils, which lead to your destruction, your demotion, and your ultimate rejection. So let us choose to be those that remember. People who forget ultimately become disloyal, and we learned how destructive and dysfunctional disloyalty is in our relationships, in our families, and in the house of God. Let us choose love, because if we choose love, we remember, and if we remember, we are faithful and never forgetful. And so with that recap in mind, let us look at the three following areas today. Number one, the common mistakes of people who forget. Number two, seven keys that will help you to remember. Number three, things that righteous people remember. Let's get into it. Eight common mistakes of people that forget. Number one, they dishonor fathers and founders. They forget the contributions made in their lives and their families in the church by their spiritual fathers and founders. And thus they lose sight of the vision. They forget the sleepless nights that their pastors spent with them. They forget the prayers. They forget the hours and hours, billable hours, mind you, of counseling. They forget the sacrifices that founders have made to build the vision which they now want to destroy. Jesus knew the church that would forget, and he instated the Holy Communion sacrament to cause us to remember. Many churches do not remember their founders. The memory of the founder dims as the years go by. His name is pushed away, and anything that reminds them of him is erased. New pastors want to remove the concept of Founders Day. They ask, what is that? The new pastor wants the picture of the founder taken away from the flyers and the posters. The current pastors love to be seen as the luminary who achieved everything on his own. Such people have forgotten the work that the founder did for the church to come into existence, the sweat and blood, the instruction that came from God to the founder of the ministry. The work of a founder and the apostle is the most difficult job of all. Apostle Paul said of founders, "For it seems to me that God has put us apostles on display at the end of the procession, like those condemned to die in the arena. We have been made a spectacle to the whole universe, to angels as well as to human beings." 1 Corinthians 4 verse 9. The founder's work is buried in the ground and many do not see it. Many founders are scarred and wounded individuals. They receive the largest amount of criticism and the least amount of appreciation. The families of apostles and founders are not exempt from this treatment either. They are often set aside and forgotten. The family may have paid an equally high price for the founder to lay the foundation he did. Upon the death of the founders and apostles, many are moved with compassion for their families and declare that they will set up foundations and trust funds for them. Sadly, with the passage of time, the passion for setting up these foundations and mobilizing the money that is needed fades away. The family of the founder is left to fend for itself and to fight for survival. Let us pray that this not be our portion in HBMI, in Jesus' name. The same can be said for many parents, aunties, uncles, grannies who raised children, who nurtured many of the successful, wealthy, powerful men and women we see today. They are forgotten and nothing is left in their honor. It is most painful when the founder's ideals are set aside, the vision on which he built the ministry. Bishop Dyke says, "I once read about a great founder and found no comparison between what he believed in and what the church he had founded was practicing. I visited the grave of this great founder and was taken on a tour of one of the founder's homes by a caretaker. One of the last comments the caretaker made was indeed very sad. He said, 'This great founder would be very sad if he rose from the dead today.' 'Why?' I asked. He continued, 'Most of the vices he fought against are the ones currently plaguing the church that he founded.' Sadly, the founder's ideals had been set aside. Even though this founder's name is certainly not forgotten, his ideals and vision have been set aside. The danger of all this is that the curse of dishonoring fathers will follow the current leaders. It is an important principle to honor fathers. Ham, the son of Noah, the black son of Noah, broke this principle and dishonored his father. It is the curse that follows and governs large sections of the world's population. Across the world, the inability of the black man to rise above the state of servanthood can only be explained by a curse. Others may differ in their view, and I can handle that, but I find it difficult to explain the state of Africa and black people in general, except by interpreting it as the curse of Ham. This severe curse came about when a young man forgot the contribution his father had made to his existence. Ham, the father of Canaan, saw his father naked and told his two brothers outside. Genesis chapter 9 verse 22. Ham forgot that it was his father Noah who heard from God and obeyed the call. Ham forgot that he did not know God well enough to hear the voice that commanded to build an ark. Ham forgot that his father had not built the ark, he would have drowned along with the rest of the world. Hebrews 11 verse 7 says, "By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became the heir of righteousness that is in keeping with faith." Ham forgot that God had judged Noah to be a righteous man, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Genesis chapter 6 verse 8 says, Ham forgot that he was alive only because of his drunken father whom God had found righteous. Ham forgot that every man of God has a right to be naked in his own tent. He forgot that he himself was sometimes naked in his own tent. He forgot too many things and he paid dearly for his lack of remembrance. Today, the black men can scarcely rise out of the waters of worldwide despisement. God forbid that this be our portion. Number two, people who forget become disobedient. Will you remember God when he promotes you, elevates you, enriches you, and prospers you? When he heals and restores your family, breaks the curse, gives you money, power, and access? Will you remember him? Will you remember where he brought you from and who he used to elevate you? David never forgot Samuel and even Saul and Jonathan, despite what Saul did to him. He declared himself cursed cursed should he even forget Jerusalem? Yet we so easily forget. Can we truly handle the blessings of God? Very often it seems as Christians we can't. When we are picked out of nowhere, from the back of beyond, looking like the back of the bus, as Apostle Charles always used to say, and God promotes us through others, mind you, we forget. We dishonor, we backslide, we criticize, we disobey, we compromise, we become full of pride, and we are sure to face a fall. We do not repent. Such was the fate of Jeroboam, picked out of nowhere, a nobody, chosen by God, but he forgot. Jeroboam was chosen by the Lord to replace Solomon. Jeroboam, a nobody, was picked to replace the ruling lineage of David and Solomon, two of the greatest kings of Israel. Jeroboam was given this honor because Solomon had gone after idols and worshipped false gods. Read about this in 1 Kings chapter 11 from verse 30 to 33. Somehow, when Jeroboam became the king, he forgot why he was chosen in the first place. The prophet Ahijah had made it very clear why Jeroboam was chosen, but he forgot. He forgot why God had chosen him in place of Solomon. He forgot the most important thing and disobeyed the Lord in the exact same way that Solomon had. In 1 Kings chapter 12 from verse 26, but I'll read verse 31, it says, Jeroboam built shrines on high places and appointed priests from all sorts of people, even though they were not Levites. He instituted a festival on the 15th day of the 8th month, like the festival held in Judah, and offered sacrifices on the altar. This he did in Bethel, sacrificing to the calves he had made. And at Bethel, he also installed priests at the high places that he had made. Wow. Paul declared that he knew how to stay close to God whilst poor and also when rich. This is a secret that Christians seem to lack, how to remember God when they are promoted as much as they remember him when they are poor. Paul said in Philippians 4 verse 12, I know how to get along with humble means, and I also know how to live in prosperity. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of being filled and going hungry, both having abundance and suffering need. Number 3, people who forget become proud. How often have we seen Christians enter office, public office, and then suddenly become inaccessible to the church or too busy? Businessmen become prosperous and become too busy for their shepherding pastors and too big for the assembly in the local branch that they were raised in and nurtured in. How often have we seen children who prosper and fly high in their careers become too busy to visit their parents, to bless their grandmothers, to interact with their cousins and extended family, too committed financially to be able to support their parents or their siblings? And how often do we see a gifted and anointed Elisha become too spiritual, too deep, too insightful, too prayerful, too powerful, and too discerning to take heed of the words of the Elijah's guidance? In a lot of these instances, these forgetful people will need you so desperately before they break through, and forget you so completely during the time of their promotion, but sadly come back to needing you when they eventually face their demotion. True friend, a true son, a true believer is one who will remember you just as clearly when they're up there as when they are not. Number 4, people who forget can easily get divorced. Unfortunately, many people forget the words they spoke to each other during their marriage ceremony. And I'll read from the book. Till death do us part, they say boldly. They declare, for better and for worse. Others vow, in prosperity and in adversity, we shall live together. They assert that if any man will break up this union, it will be Satan. Forgetting what you have said can go against you greatly. Most couples do not remember what they said to each other. Many wives forget how they proclaim, from this day forward, I shall love you and I shall give myself to you. Years later, when they are in bed with their husbands, they forget how they said, I shall give myself to you. When they exchange rings, they say, let this ring be a symbol of our love for eternity. Unfortunately, the ring has become a symbol of sadness, bondage, and quarrels. One of the main reasons for divorce is forgetting what we said to each other. Most of the time, the promises are made in our youth. By our middle age, we have forgotten what we said in our youth. God is against those who do not remember what they said in their youth. The Bible actually refers to the wife as the wife of your youth. She is the woman that you liked when you were young and zealous and full of love. The scripture urges you to remember the words of your covenant. You ask why? This is Malachi chapter 2, verse 14 and 16. It is because the Lord is the witness between you and the wife of your youth. You have been unfaithful to her, though she is your partner, the wife of your marriage covenant. Has not the one God made you? You belong to him in body and spirit. And what does the one God seek? Godly offspring. So be on your guard. Do not be unfaithful to the wife of your youth. Verse 16 says, the man who hates and divorces his wife, says the Lord, the God of Israel, does violence to the one who he should protect, says the Lord Almighty. So be on your guard and do not be unfaithful. Number 5, people who forget become presumptuous. We learn from the story of Korah and the sons of Korah in the time of Moses. Numbers chapter 16 from verse 8 and 9. And Moses said to Korah, hear now, you sons of Levi. Is it too small a thing for you that the God of Israel has separated you from the congregation of Israel to bring you near to himself, to do service in the tabernacle of the Lord and stand before the congregation to minister to them? The rebellion of Korah is of particular note because Moses rebuked Korah for his presumption. Presumption is the arrogant assumption of privilege. When a person becomes presumptuous, he's too confident in a way that shows lack of respect. Korah completely disrespected who God had raised Moses to be and started to feel like God could speak to all of us. Why does Moses think he's so special? Why does Moses think that he's the only one fit to lead? When people are fortunate enough to occupy certain certain positions, they often do not realize what a privilege they have. Moses recognized this in Korah. Korah had the privilege of being a Levite and a leader of the congregation, yet he spoke the rudest words to Moses, a chosen servant of God. They assembled together against Moses and Aaron and said to them, "You have gone far enough. All the congregation are holy. Every one of them. All of us have an opinion. All of us can hear God. You are not the only one that hears God," is what Korah and his people were saying. He said, "And the Lord is in everyone's midst, so why do you exalt yourselves above the assembly of the Lord?" This is Numbers chapter 16, verse 3. How often do we hear this kind of conversation even in the church? It's sad how even parents can rise up against their children and begin to question the authority that their parents have over them. We all know what happened to Korah. The ground literally opened up and swallowed him and everything that belonged to him, his children, his cattle, his cap, and probably the rats that lived under his tent. Bishop Doug, in his book, shares an experience that he had with a young brother in the ministry who he raised into pastoring and who later left the church. He talks about how after some years, he had an exchange with this fellow. And he says, "I had several exchanges with this fellow, some of which were not pleasant. One day during one of our exchanges, he pointed out to me that I was complaining about what was unavoidable and that he could not help it if our church members were being attracted to his new church, which he had planted not far from ours." In other words, he said Bishop Dagg needed to cure his insecurities. This dear pastor pointed out to Bishop Dagg that he himself had planted churches all over the place without apparent regard for their closeness to other churches. He also pointed out to Bishop Dagg that he had started churches with other people's members too. He went on to put a direct question to me, says Bishop Dagg. "Why do you contradict yourself?" Then he advised me to come to terms with the realities of pastors leaving my church. "Otherwise, I would fight with everyone that ever lived." I was amazed as he continued, "You appointed me as a pastor and I honored that appointment with my sweat and money. I owe you nothing further." He finally warned me, saying, "I will hold you personally responsible for anything that happens to my marriage." Bishop Dagg says he forgot, but I remembered. I thought over these things for a long time. I considered how prosperous and wealthy he had become over the years and how confidently he rebuked and advised me today. But I also remembered how years ago this brother, who was not rebuking me, this Bishop Dagg speaking, was an impoverished illegal immigrant who could not afford his own lunch. Now it seemed a small thing to him to have been lifted from his former state to where he currently was. He could not remember his starting point, and that is why he spoke so confidently in a way that showed lack of respect and presumption. You see, we all start from humble beginnings, and this is true. But a lot of people forget the role that you played in their lives. Bishop Dagg continues and says, "Perhaps he had forgotten how I encouraged him to go into ministry. It seems he had forgotten how I chose him and sent him to a particular country, which he knew not. He had forgotten that he would never have had the wife if I had not told her to marry him. I remember when his wife asked me about him, she did not want to marry, and especially did not want to marry him. But I convinced her and told her that he was a good person before he married her. I had such authority over his wife, and she would have done anything I told her. In those days, the words and advice I gave her were like the oracles of God. Whatever I said was what mattered. Through his marriage, which I sponsored, this brother had now become a member of a well-known family and enjoyed the privileged financial wealth and inheritance of that family. It seemed like all these things had been forgotten by this brother who was now saying he owed me nothing. Perhaps I would have to join Paul in saying, "I do not say to thee how thou owest unto me even thine own self." This brother said that he owed me nothing, but Paul said to Philemon that he owed him his very life. This is in Philemon chapter 1 verse 19. It is always interesting to watch the sons of Korah rebuke their fathers. They love to put their fathers in place. It seems a small thing to them. It's only because people forget where they were and who they were that they speak great words swelling with arrogance. Please do not repeat these errors. Number 6, people who forget become rebellious. Samuel chapter 15 verse 17. Samuel continued, "Although you once considered yourself unimportant, haven't you become the leader of the tribes of Israel? The Lord anointed you king over Israel." Saul did not remember to obey the Lord when he was lifted up. Samuel reminded him that he was a nobody before God called and anointed him. It was Saul's rebellion that led to his ultimate demise. Forgetting will cause you to lose some of the most important things in your life. Saul lost the throne because he forgot. Number 7, people who forget become second-rate ministers. And I like this one. Remembering gives you authenticity. Many preachers are boring and empty because they cannot and do not acknowledge their truth. They cannot share their real life accounts because they're fake, because they're phonies, because they aren't proud of who they are, or because they've tried so hard to be somebody else, to reinvent themselves. We see the same in many children today. Children that are now adults who are confused and have identity crises, who talk with weird accents, who will lie about their upbringing because they would rather deny their background. Many ministers lose power because they cannot stand on their testimony. The Bible tells us that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Some of these preachers do not have a testimony to talk of because they have dishonored their fathers, dishonored their spiritual leaders, dishonored their backgrounds. Apostle Paul often told his story and experience in great detail. We see this in Acts chapters 26 verse 11, where Paul is telling Agrippa how Jesus apprehended him. We also see it in Galatians chapter 1 from verse 15 to 18, where Paul is telling the Galatians about his early ministry. We see it in Philippians chapter 3 from verse 4, where Paul is telling the Philippians about his childhood. In Corinthians, he tells them about his personal problems and his feelings in both 2 Corinthians chapter 11 from verse 23, 2 Corinthians 1 from verse 8 and 10. Paul constantly gave detailed accounts of his life, and you have to be able to do the same. Do not be someone that forgets who you are. You will lose your authenticity and you will lose your anointing. Number 8, those who forget lack compassion in ministry. Why is it that the increase to access to scripture in the world has not led to an increase of compassion by believers? Why are Christians still so stingy? Why can they still walk past the poor, the blind, the sick, the lame, the needy, the brokenhearted without extending themselves? Why? Why is it that we still neglect those that raised us, good or bad, or to the best of their knowledge or ability? The fact is that person raised you. There's somebody that sacrificed whatever they had to whatever extent, or you, whether they were your parents, your extended family. Why do you choose to live selfishly and think nothing of the struggles and the sacrifices that those people once made to help you? You dishonor and you even criticize those that raised you, those that shepherded you, those that assisted you, those that gave you a hand up in business. You show no compassion to those in need, whether they're people from your past or strangers or brethren in the future. Many believers have become like the Pharisees that walked past the half-dead man on the side of the road. But God desires that we be like the Good Samaritan that we read about in Luke chapter 10. Having the kind of compassion needed for ministry goes along with the ability to remember. People have no compassion because they do not remember. And so with that in mind, let's touch on 7 keys to help you remember. Number 1, study history. Pharaoh forgot the history. It says, and a Pharaoh arose who did not know Joseph. The fact that Pharaoh forgot this history came at a very great cost to him and his family and his entire nation, as you then read in the story of Moses in Exodus. So study history, number 1. Number 2, do not let success erode your memory. Deuteronomy chapter 8 verse 18 says, but remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms his covenant which he swore to your ancestors as it is today. Remember the Lord. Verse 10 of the same chapter says, when you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commandments, his laws, and his decrees that I am giving you this day. Verse 12 says, otherwise when you eat and are satisfied, when you build fine houses and settle down, when your herds and flocks grow large, and your silver and gold increase, and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud, and you will forget the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. If God has blessed you with wealth, with success, with money, with giftings that are celebrated, with growth and with favor, do not let those things erode your memory. Remember, it is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle. It is important to remember. Number 3 of the keys on how to remember. Do not let the passage of time erode your memory. Some people remember for a little bit, but as time passes on, they forget. The chief butler forgot about Joseph when he became free, and it took several years before he remembered Joseph, although Joseph was the one that prophesied his freedom. People need to be reminded, and don't be offended by reminders. Don't be offended by your leader's reminders. And leaders, don't be afraid to remind people. Allow yourself to simply be corrected when you are reminded. Bishop Dyke writes, at different times, the Lord used me to start different fellowships, groups, and churches, and I'm sure a lot of pastors, including our very own apostles, can relate to this. He says, sometimes I would hand over the group to a leader and leave them there for some time. Invariably, they forgot me. They forgot how they began, and they forgot about me. With the passage of time, they did not even want my involvement anymore. I remember one particular fellowship I started and allowed to run for some time. Later on, I came back to them and explained that I wanted to take up the leadership of the group again. After a series of discussions, I sensed that my leadership was not welcome anymore, so I abandoned the idea. I reflected on the turn of events. As I thought over the situation, I considered how easily people forget where they come from. These people had forgotten that they did not even know each other before I had pulled them together and introduced them to one another. In addition, they had forgotten that none of them had a vision for such fellowship. I had the vision and invited them to participate. Also, they had forgotten that all the activities they currently engaged in were things I had instituted. They had forgotten how associating with me had led them to enjoy the relationships they now cherished. But such is the lot of a founder. He must be prepared to be forgotten and set aside. This is the reason why people hold on to leadership positions until they die. They fear to hand over their prized vision to men who will forget. Tip number 4 to remembering is recognize the hand of God in everything that happens. Many people do not understand how or why they are blessed. They just enjoy blessings, but they don't understand how they are acquired. In Daniel chapter 5 verse 23 and 4, it says, but you have not praised the God who gives you breath of life and controls your destiny. We read about Belshazzar, the king who praised the gods of silver and gold and wood and stone, but he did not honor the God who had really lifted him up. The prophet Daniel rebuked Belshazzar for not remembering the one who really mattered. He holds our breath in his hands and he controls all our ways. He is therefore the source of all our blessings. How can we forget the one who controls everything about our lives? We cannot live a day longer than God allows. allows. We cannot do anything that he does not allow. He holds the whole world in his hand. We must not forget Elohim, our creator, who rules all our affairs. Number 5, continually recognize the people God has used in your life. Laban said unto Jacob, I pray thee, if I have found favor in thine eyes, tarry, for I have learned by experience that the Lord has blessed me for that, for thy sake. You see the same with Joseph and Potiphar's house. Potiphar acknowledged that God was blessing him because of Joseph. Many people forget because they don't recognize God's vessel. They do not realize that they are where they are because God blessed them through their association with someone. A failure to understand this is the cause of many of life's disasters. It takes humility to recognize that God has chosen certain people, given them a call, and favored all those who help their cause. God chose Israel and has blessed all those who help that nation, and there's nothing we can do about God's choices. Laban was an unbeliever who recognized that his blessings had come by associating with Jacob. He did not want to part company with Jacob because he sensed that the blessing came by the association. When the Ark of the Covenant was in the house of Obed-Edom, everything flourished. His house was fully blessed because of the presence of the Ark of the Covenant. And it was told King David, saying, the Lord has blessed the house of Obed-Edom and all that pertaineth unto him because of the Ark of God. This is 2 Samuel chapter 6 verse 12. A wise and spiritual person will attach himself to people who are recognizably called and favored by the Lord. What you need is to tap into some of the grace given to that person. People forget how they were lifted from the depths to great height by relating with a particular person. Number 6, grow in your understanding of why God blesses people. A Chinese proverb says, you hear, you forget. You see, you remember. You do, and you understand. So let us aim to understand. The real secret behind King David's blessing was his wholehearted service to the living God. Perhaps not understanding the secret behind someone's success will lead you to set aside the very thing which made him great. For when Solomon was old, his wives turned his heart away after other gods, and his heart was not wholly devoted to the Lord his God as the heart of his father David had been. Solomon worked so hard for God. He built this amazing temple. He experienced the blessing of the Lord, but he didn't realize the secret as to why his father was so blessed. And as a result, he lost the throne. And number 7, which is our last key, is do not have a rebellious blackout. If you want to be those that remember, do not have blackouts. Philemon chapter 1 verse 17 to 19 says, so you consider me a partner? So if you consider me a partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has done you any wrong or owes you anything, charge it to me. Verse 19 says, I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will pay it back. Not to mention that you owe me your very self. Paul, like many fathers and apostles, would not bother to tell the young ones that they actually owed their entire lives to him. Philemon did not just owe him gratitude for some nice teachings. Philemon did not just owe him gratitude for some powerful prayers. He owed his very life to him. One day, Paul decided to point out to Philemon because he was asking a favor. There are people who rebel against authority, and therefore they need to wipe out the memory of those who have helped them. When people do not want to show gratitude, they consciously black out the memory of the good things done for them and the people who did them. They selectively retain the things that they want to remember and delete the memory of other things. We see this so often. They then try to attribute their excess to other reasons, minimizing any reference to the one who actually helped them. This is so sad. They say things like, I would have been here anyway. I would have been in the ministry anyway. I would have been successful anyway. I would have gotten a scholarship anyway. I would have been ordained anyway. I would have created a better life elsewhere anyway. Somebody would have come for me. Something would have given in my life. I would have traveled to these countries anyway. They also say things like, I cannot say thank you forever for the rest of my life. I have honored you enough. Some even go to the extent of saying, what do I have to give you so that I don't owe you anything anymore? And I think those are the most hurtful words that you could ever speak to somebody that helped you out of the goodness of their heart. But Paul told Philemon, you owe me your whole life. Besides, you see, there are things that affect all aspects of your life. The receiving of salvation is not just the receiving of a good teaching. It is the rescuing of an entire life. To be in the ministry is not just another opportunity to occupy some social position. You're not volunteering. It is the highest privilege that can be given to a human being with unimaginable eternal rewards. There is nothing higher than working for the King of Kings. Many of the things that we have in life are because of the anointing of the man and woman of God that has raised us. Never forget that. Never dishonor that. Whether you feel like they have too much or you have given them enough, never forget where you come from. Never forget that many things are often related to that one person in your life. Never forget that this could be your last opportunity to thank them or to bless them as they have so often blessed you. And so as we go into our last segment, we're going to share 10 things that righteous people remember. Number 1, righteous people remember important anniversaries. Deuteronomy 16 verse 3 says, thou shalt eat no leavened bread with it. 7 days thou shalt eat unleavened bread therewith, even the bread of affliction, and so on and so on and so on. Dates and anniversaries were important. Most people just remember their own birthdays, but there are other days that are more important important than your birthday. Like the day you were born again, like the day you were filled with the Spirit, the day you were healed, the day you were called to the ministry. What about the day you came out of a near-death experience? What about the day someone helped you out of a critical situation? What about the day someone introduced you to that important person that led to that business deal? What about the day you were helped and the day you were promoted? What about the day Jesus was born, the day he died, and the day he rose from the dead? These are important dates for every Christian to remember. Number two, people who are righteous remember their low points and how they came out of them. Remember that thou was a servant in the land of Egypt, and that thy Lord God brought thee out with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. This is Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 15. Therefore, the Lord thy God commanded you to keep the Sabbath day. People who are righteous remember exactly who helped them out of their low point. In this scripture, the Lord emphasizes that he brought them out of the land of Egypt. It is easy to ascribe honor to someone who didn't really help you. Now that you have prospered, you can. You can easily say, I would have had it anyway. I would have managed anyway. I would have made it anyway. It is easy to forget the people who helped you at the critical moments of your life. Deuteronomy 6 verse 12 says, then beware lest thou forget the Lord which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. Number three, people who remember are able to overcome their fears. Deuteronomy 7 verse 18 says, thou shalt not be afraid of them, but thou shalt remember what the Lord thy God did unto Pharaoh and unto all Egypt. People who don't remember are filled with fear. If you remember what God has done for you through the years, you will be filled with faith. Revelation 12 verse 11, we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. You will know that all things are possible. You will know that the same God can do it again. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. When you forget the great things that God has done, all kinds of irrational fear grips your heart. And those fears can lead you on a journey of destruction. Number four, people who are righteous remember the commandments of the Lord. So you remember his commandments, you keep his commandments, and you obey the word of God that comes from his prophets, from the shepherds that he has put over you. A good employee always takes a notebook and starts writing when the boss starts speaking. Why does a good employee write things down? Everybody forgets instructions that they don't write down. If you don't make an extra effort, you will soon forget the things that the Lord has asked you to do. If you don't take notes in leadership meetings, in home church, in cell group, on Sunday services, you will forget the things that the Lord God has spoken to you. Number five, righteous people remember the old days. Remember the days of old. Consider the years of many generations. Ask thy father and he will show thee, thy elders and they will tell thee. Deuteronomy 32 verse 7 says, young people often make the mistake of thinking that everything old is useless. Remembering the days of old is what we call studying history, and we've discussed the importance of remembering history. Anyone who does not study history will be surprised at life, and this is why God's instruction is to remember the days of old. Number six, righteous people remember the benefits of the Lord. Psalms 103 verse 2 says, bless the Lord, all my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Every good and perfect gift comes from above. It is necessary to remember this. Why? Because forgetting leads to murmuring, discontentment, bitterness, and strife. And remember, evil spirits inhabit murmurers. Forgetful people must never work in full-time ministry. There will be too much to complain about. Full-time ministry is reserved for people that can see benefits, remember benefits, and be grateful for those benefits even in rough times. If you can remember the benefits, you will carry the right attitude when you're promoted. And that attitude will sustain you and cause you to remember those that you suffered with even before you were promoted. The thief on the cross knew that Jesus was just about to be promoted. He begged Jesus to remember him when the promotion came. Is this not what we pray for when our friends are lifted up? Jesus promised to put the thief in paradise. Unfortunately, when an ordinary person is promoted through politics or marriage or football, they do not remember the commoners anymore. Please remember us in the days that you are promoted. Number seven, righteous people remember what God does to people just like them. And this is not a good thing. Luke 17 verse 32 says, remember Lot's wife. Remember what the Lord did to Lot's wife? Jesus urged his followers to remember Lot's wife. Lot's wife speaks of someone who looks back instead of forward. She represents all those who follow the Lord, but their hearts are somewhere else. The Bible says anyone who sets their hands on their plow but looks back is not fit for service, is not fit to work in the kingdom, is not fit to follow Christ. Lot's wife did not deserve to be among the few that were saved from Sodom and Gomorrah. That is why she turned into a pillar of salt. Every minister should remember Lot's wife. Every pastor's wife and every pastor should remember, and every pastor's husband should remember Lot's wife. Every Christian should remember to serve the Lord without looking back. Remember, a relationship with God is a personal thing. It's not a family thing, not a group thing. Remember what God did to Miriam when her and Aaron tried to upstage Moses. These examples are examples of what God can do to people that are behaving just the same way you are. Use these reminders to straighten out and to change your ways. Number 8, righteous people remember the poor and the prisoner. Galatians 2 verse 10 says, all they asked was that we should continue to remember the poor, the very thing that I had been eager to do all along. You don't have to be urged to remember the rich. It is natural to remember those that are prominent among you. But God desires that we also remember the poor, those that need so much and that continually need things from us, those with problems, those that are downcast, those that are brokenhearted, those that are in poverty and lack. The scripture is clear that poor people should be remembered and included in our plan. Prisoners are also part of our society, and every pastor must preach in the prisons of his country. Amen. Continue to remember those in prison as if you were together with them in prison, says the word of God, and those who are mistreated as if you yourselves are suffering, Hebrews chapter 13 verse 3. Number 9, second from last, righteous people remember God's servants. Hebrews 13 verse 7 says, remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. We must also remember the servants of God in our lives. Many church members have stable and normal lives because of the direction and inspiration they receive from their church. Yet the pastor is often last to be remembered. Sometimes people speak of their new jobs, new contracts, and salary increases. Often all we see is a new car, a new house, and more celebration. The pastor is not often considered in the new dispensation of prosperity. Actually, when he dares to ask for support for the ministry, he's told about the mortgages, the loans, and the other bills that have to be paid. The pastor is also informed how certain contracts and payments have not yet materialized. Then he's promised that he will be remembered when things work out. When people do not support the ministry, they often do not support the pastor himself. The righteous person will remember the pastor who labors spiritually for them. Number 10, righteous people remember what they have received. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Hold fast and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. Revelation chapter 3 verse 3 says. Sometimes we forget the different gifts that we have received. If God gave you 5 talents, you will be judged for the use of all 5. Yo, and this really spoke to me. Many people have forgotten what they have received. Some of us have put aside some of our gifts. Some of us have trivialized certain gifts, thinking of them as nothing or not as important as the others. May God help us. A great prophet described a vision in which he saw the Lord. He told of how the Lord had rebuked him for not using the prophetic gift as much as he should have. The Lord told him that his life would be shortened if he did not repent and use this gift. Let us remember what we have received, because we will have to account for every single thing and every single gift that we have been given. And so may God help us to be people that remember. May he help us to avoid the mistakes of people that forget. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you all, and thank you so much for this opportunity to share. In Jesus' name.